Okay, let's get started. Good evening, good afternoon, depending on your time frame. Everybody, my name is Tim Oakes, and I'm the faculty director of the Center for Asian Studies. And on behalf of the Center for Asian Studies and the Tibet Himalaya Initiative, it's my pleasure to welcome you to this event that we've really been looking forward to quite a while. We're really proud to be able to host Dorje Doma, who is not only an accomplished author, but also an alumna of the University of Colorado here. And so we're happy to have her come and give a talk. Before I turn things over, or before Dorje starts speaking, I want to introduce a woman who appears in Dorje's book, Yak Girl, as the Inja, or white woman, who appears at a particular critical juncture in Dorje's young life, who appears in the book. So please welcome Jen Cleary.
Hi, everybody. 23 years ago, about this month, I was volunteering in a medical clinic in Kathmandu when in walked a family of five. And one of the children was perfectly healthy, beautiful, young girls, and then there was a boy who was dying of measles, who would have died if he hadn't walked into the medical clinic within a week or two. He was easily able to get medical help. And then there was a third child who walked in and was extremely deformed, and walked in like this, and she had, as it turns out, a severe scoliosis, and her spine was crushing her heart and lungs. I took her to numerous doctors there in Kathmandu. The medical help was so limited that that they said, forget it, you can't help her. You can help the boy with the measles with American medicine, but you can't help this child. She's got about 2 years to live, and you might as well forget about it. Well, I decided to be optimistic and take her x-rays back to America, where I was able to find people who said, sure, we'll help. And so I was able to put together medical care for Dorje. And I was able to go back and bring her here. And she went through 2 years of excruciatingly painful spine correction surgeries. The doctors were able to save her life. And then she was able to go on and graduate. She went to Boulder High, she went to Columbine, all the schools here in Boulder. And then she was able to graduate right here from the University of Colorado. Dorje is about to embark on a worldwide tour with this book that I cannot believe has been written. She's been working on it for 15 years now, and it finally came together this year, and it's a remarkable book with remarkable stories. And here to tell you about her life in person is Dorje Doma.
Coming to my event, especially I'm really excited because one, I went to school here, and I had two classes here, and over there is I took a couple naps. I used to take a nap, and I know there's some students here, and you can probably can relate. My first year at CU was a little rough. The first week, I got scammed. Some guy told me that I could buy a magazine for $46, so I did. I never saw that magazine. And then it snowed, and then I wanted to show my friends that my yak herding skills. So I was in the field next to the music building, and sort of in the evening, and I made snowballs, and when I was herding yaks, I had this little rope and like swing the rock to herd the yak, but I did it with a scarf and a snowball. And first it almost hit the Libby building, and then it hit the music building, and I couldn't really see. So I thought, oh my God, I was like mortified because I thought, oh my gosh, they're gonna kick me out. But luckily the snowball just hit the wall. So that's when I said to myself, Dorje, you're here to study, not herd yaks. So speaking of yaks, let's go into the world of Yak Girl. So 23 years ago, I was living up in the Himalayas, 13,000 feet, chasing wool frozen snow leopards from my herd of goats and sheep, and I didn't know if I would live to attend due to my health condition. I would not survive. And today I stand in front of you all with my 328-page book, which only took 15 years. But I'm very happy to share the story. So the stories that I'm about to share are from when I was 5 to 10. So I just wanted to give you that. Yeah, I guess I often have questions about how old I was on each event. So let's all go into the world of Yak Girl and imagine living at a place as high as 13,000 feet, above tree level, and there are no roads, no electricity, no schools, no Medicare, yet people still choose to live here because the land is majestically beautiful, the air is crisp, clean, it's quiet and peaceful. I would like you all to welcome to my village, Garam. Garam is located in northwestern part of Nepal, called Dobo, bordering Tibet, where my ancestors have lived here as early as 8th century, practicing ancient Tibetan culture and religion. Some of my favorite memories as a child was spending hours along the river valley below my house. The river was my friend and my playground, and I sang songs along with the soothing sound of water, and the gifts that the river brought down of sticks and stones, I built little rock houses. Nature often was my main source of comfort for guidance, especially for when I was having a difficult time. So here is my house, and here's the river valley. And there are no targets, so I'm stuck with the river. There are times I just wanted to do nothing but play next to the river. But I had many responsibilities. I started working at age 5, taking care of my family's horses, cows, and younger siblings. And one of my early chores was to take our horse to a stream near our river. And I would watch the horse graze for hours and then collected the horse dung in the straw basket and brought it home to dry because we didn't have firewood, so we used animal dung for cooking our meals and staying warm. Here's my house, and here's the stream with the horse. And I sometimes had a little problem with the horse because they'll step on me, they'll bite on me. But I was like, you know, all I'm doing is trying to take care of you. I don't know what your problem is. And most of the time, we get along. This is our house, our family pride. It is a simple house made out of stone, mud, and animal dung, built on my father's family, a land from my father's family. And in this house, my mother gave birth to many children, and I was often the midwife. I washed the newborn babies, I buried the placenta. And we also struggled to survive in this house due to the long, harsh winter, lack of food, and medical care. We also grieved over the loss of 5 of my younger siblings. As the oldest of 11 children, I was often like a second parent to my younger siblings because my parents had to work in the field planting potatoes, barley, and buckwheat, our main source of food. I love watching my siblings play next to the river, making little rock dolls, and I had to carry the babies on my back. But the hardest part of taking care of my sibling was losing them. I remember losing 2 of my siblings, a sister and a brother. And one of my sister, when she died, I had to help cremate her and on top of our rooftop. Another time, I lost a baby brother who I became very attached to. And one day he got sick and died from quickly die. And I remember becoming completely numb and went into a depression where, and at that was the first time I understood my mother, because every year when we lost a child, or sometimes two in a year, she would go through this long depression, and it was very hard to be around, like as if we always have cloud over our house. But that was the first time I understood my mother. And the one thing about grieving over my siblings was that it was just this, like, I remember there were, when it happened so many times, I just didn't want to be inside. I just felt like my siblings are out. And in fact, when my sister died, I had to collect her ashes in the morning and then sprinkle it over that mountain, hoping that her ashes will, she'll be free finally from pain. As I mentioned in my book, in order to survive, every member in the family had to work and make everything by hand. And we use wool and animal skin as our main source of clothing. So here my mother is spinning wool to make blankets and dresses. And in the middle are traditional Dobo blankets and belts hand-woven by my family members. And on the right is a traditional Dobo boot hand-sewed by my father. I have that now. So in my house, my mother did the weaving and my father did the sewing. And these skills are passed down to the next generation. So Dobo is located in northwestern part of Nepal, and I just want to put that just to kind of give you a distance. Very far, right here, there. And it is considered the most remote place in the world and isolated from the rest of Nepal because there's no road and no electricity. So walking is the only way of traveling. And that is very challenging to do because we often face broken bridges, cliffs, so lots of walking and don't look down kind of thing. And we also face heavy snowfall and face avalanche. So in fact, just last year, when a family was walking from the city of Kathmandu to Dobo, and they got hit by a major avalanche, and one of those child died during that journey. Dobo Pa is the people of Dobo, are called the people of Dobo. They're culturally Tibetan, and they speak a Tibetan dialect, and they practice combination of ancient Bon and Tibetan Buddhism. And these are my family members standing on top of my house on the rooftop. We like to stay in the rooftop a lot because there's no heater. So the sun is our main source of warmth, especially in the winter. Here's my father. My father is both a Tibetan doctor and a lama, a lay lama. Lama is like a priest. And he often performs pujas in people's homes if somebody's for newborn children or somebody's sick. But he also often does pujas on rooftop. But he has been a Tibetan doctor in my village for over 16 years, and he also has traveled to Tibet as a doctor there. And I used to help collect his medicine, you know, way up in the mountains. Has anybody read the book called The Snow Leopard? Oh, look at that. So you know all about Dobo, so what am I doing here? So Peter Matheson was one of the first Westerners who would go to Dobo and to discover this mysterious land and people and write about it in his book, Snow Leopard, which I found at the library when I first came here. And I asked somebody, what is this book about? And they said, well, it's he's looking for snow leopard. And I said, did they find it? He said, no. Well, then he should have found me. I was trying to get rid of one. And has anyone seen the movie Himalaya? So the movie Himalaya is directed by a French filmmaker named Eric Vallée, and it got nominated for Oscar. And the film was filmed in Dobo, showing the lives of people in Dobo. And when I first saw the movie in Denver, I was just shocked because I felt like I was watching a family documentary. Because I saw my great aunt, my neighbors. I was still new here, and the film was right there. So I felt very home. Dope was recently become well known through this Shapook Songdo National Park. Many tourists come here to see the turquoise color lake. And this lake was also shown in the movie Himalaya. It's a really, really beautiful color, turquoise color lake. The man on the horse is my great-great-grandfather, Nima Tsering. He was an important figure in Dobo, both politically and religiously. And he was the head chief of all of Upper Dobo until his death in 1963. I didn't know about that until last year that I was Googling around, that I learned about this in a British archive, that he was the head chief and from Dobo. And I lived in his house as a child. The house was filled with religious books and had swords and guns hanging on the wall. I mean, I felt like his presence was there whenever I was there. And he's also written in these two books. I found this photo in the Four Lamas of Dobo book. So besides taking care of animals, my other job was I was a herder, which means no weekends. I mean, I look forward to weekends right now, but I had to take the animals to the mountain, sometimes as high as 18,000 feet for grazing. And I had to take care of cows, horses, goats, sheep, yaks, and zogs. And one of my most important jobs was to make sure they didn't get eaten by the wolves and the snow leopards. Small task. So these are male yaks, and yaks are a very important part of our culture. It's like having a car. The male yaks often are used for when we will travel. They carry everything for us. And one of my favorite things to do with the male yaks was that I sometimes like to pick a fight with them, which is. So one time I was bored, and they were just hanging around. And during mating season, they tend to be a little, you know, they're showing off who's strong. And one day, I was just like, I was bored. So I started to, like, dig holes and make grunting noises. And then there's this big male yak who's getting all ready. And then I was like, oh my gosh, he's coming close to me. And then that's when I went, boo. So. When you watch yaks every day, you start to pick up bad habits. But mostly, I took care of the female yaks and the babies. And the female yaks are called do. And I would sometimes heard about this many yaks in a day or even more. And sometimes I would have that many yaks and the horses. And the cows, and the goats, and the sheep. It's a day when you don't want to sleep. And the hardest part of the herding job is sometimes in the spring, I became a midwife to the animals. So sometimes I would have like four or five goats giving birth, and the yaks giving a birth, and then the vulture is like, ooh, snack time, and then they take the goat away. So then I'm like talking to the mother goat, it's your responsibility to watch your baby. Okay, I got like five things going on here. So, spring's a little challenging. And these are goats. So most Mostly I took care of the goats and sheep, and sometimes I washed about that many at a time. And it wasn't hard. It's a lot of making sure where they go. Luckily, the goats are really good about staying together. Unlike the zoo is half cow and half yak. They provide us with lots of milk, and I think they know that too, because they have a little attitude problem. And my family had this zoo. It looked a lot like this, except she was all black. And she was so stubborn. Like, she didn't want to listen. Like, she provided us milk with all year long, so she took that as her power. And she wouldn't stay with the herd. She went on her own direction. And then when it was time to milk, she only wanted to be milked by my aunt. And she wanted this specific salt. And there's a little salt from Tibet. And they're kind of like round salt. And she had to hear the salt is going into her soup. If she doesn't hear that, no milk for us. I mean, I was like, oh my God. So I was like, I used to call her the queen, so, because she had a power over the whole family. Now, here's my friend, the snow leopard. This is a snow leopard. We're friends now. I even like them on Facebook. They have 1 million fans. I have a little, like 600. You know, not that I'm comparing. We're friends right now, but when I was in Dopo, we had a little communication problem because they kept coming after my herd of goats and sheep, and I kept spotting them, you know. I'm like, you know, I'm pretty sure rocks don't have tails, so I can see you, because they spend so much of their time trying to disguise or blend themselves into the mountains and the rock. And one time, I saw a snow leopard that was almost 200 pounds that attacked my herd of goats and sheep. And I was with my friend, and it killed three and then ran down with one in its mouth to this deep ravine. Both my friend and I were so terrified. But it's my job as a herder, even if the animal's not good, I mean, they're gone, that we still use the skin and the meat for ourselves. So I ran after it. So I wanted to read a little section too, so you can experience it. Okay, so imagine 200 pound snow leopard just running down with a dead goat in its mouth. And then I'm running after it to the deep ravine. The leopard picked up the goat again and started dragging away. So I follow him into the ravine without thinking about the lack of a trail and the dangers of a giant angry animal with a half-eaten goat. I slowly slid down the slippery slope, and at the bottom I had to jump and land on the bottom of the dry ravine. When I dropped down, it startled the leopard, and he dropped the goat carcass from its mouth again. I froze for a few seconds, realizing I was a couple of feet from a huge leopard in a tight valley with no place to run, a dead goat laying between us with its tongue sticking out, stomach wide open, intestines pouring over rock, and blood everywhere. If I was here and there's the dead goat and then the snow leopard is with me, you know, a little bit closer to the wall, looking at me with the, you know, blood in its mouth, and I'm stuck in this tight ravine. It's almost as if I'm stuck in a tight, deep hole and no way of escaping. The moment I realized I didn't know how to escape, I said to the snow leopard, you know what? You can have that goat. I mean, I have the three that you already killed. So, yeah, just keep your eyes on the goat, not me. I'm just all bones, you know. By the way, do you know how to run out of here? And, you know, the snow leopard was actually, it wasn't terrifying, but it was having this thought, like, you know, maybe I can eat you I was thinking about it. But luckily, that's not the first part of my life, and I was able to escape. Now, if you want to know how I escaped, it's in the book. I did not call the animal control, that's all I'm saying. So these are blue sheep, they're wild sheep, which I'm kind of was grateful because the snow leopard often went after the blue sheep. But if the blue sheep wasn't there, they'll be coming after my herd, and then we're going to have like every day of a problem. And the blue sheep, they can run really fast. Sometimes they confuse me with the snow leopard. In fact, the first time I saw a snow leopard, I thought it was a blue sheep. And in the meantime, my herd of goats and sheep, they were panicking, and I thought, oh, just relax, it's still one of the wild sheep. But I realized that was a bit of a problem because that's when the snow leopard killed the sheep, my sheep. And this is my other friends, wolves. We're friends now. But they too also came after my herd of goats and sheep. Wolves are, unlike the snow leopards, wolves are very confident. They like to walk through the village with their whole family and, or their cousins, whoever. And they care about community and family, obviously. And I often see them quite often, sometimes single, sometimes, but most often with one or two at a time. And one time I saw five wolves. And that day, it killed one of my goats and then ran off with the sheep. And I had to get the sheep back from the five wolves. But what was worse was we just had a blizzard storm. And that was the day we finally were able to go outside. But I kind of thought, well, you know, the animal's been inside all week. They need to be out. So my sister and I decided today is a good day to do a dress-up party. So my sister and I took turn wearing my mother's wedding clothes, and I forgot about the herd. And so then I had to find them, but when they returned, somebody's told me that they saw five wolves. And I just had a feeling like, you know what, I probably should check. And that's when I saw the five wolves just eating my sheep. And by the time I got there, there was like barely anything left but the skin. But I still managed to get the skin back and put it in the basket and brought it home, which was not easy when you get chased by a dog. Do you want to know how I got escaped by five wolves? So I worked in three villages, and in Upper Togo there are more than 30 villages, and I had to go from different villages during different seasons. Because we have to move with the animals during different seasons, especially in the spring or summer. We don't want them to eat our field, so we have to take them up in the mountains. This is Karam. It's my father's birth village. It's cold, barren, and windy in the winter, but it's beautiful in the summer. So here's my house. And here is where, a little bit over here, is where the five wolves had their little feast party. And these are barley fields, all done by hand. And this is the irrigation system. So in this, every member in the village and also village nearby have to hand dig to create irrigation. This is Saldang. Saldang is where I was born, and also my mother was born. This is her birth village. And I worked here taking care of my grandparents' animals. And that's also where I saw my first wolves and snow leopards. Namdo is this village also nearby Saldang. And in the spring, I had to make sure the animals didn't eat off the neighbor's field. But that was a real hard task because the goats only wanted to eat the neighbor's field. And guess who gets in trouble? Not the goats. I do. And in the summer, I went up in a place called Shea. Shea is about 18,000 feet, and that's where Peter Matheson went looking for snow leopard in the winter. Don't do that. Because most villages don't stay up there. They go down to lower villages. And I stay in the Shea, taking care of the animals, and we lived as a nomad, traveling from one summer pasture to another. Sometimes we stay in a cabin, other times in a tent made from yak fur. And here's our main camp right here. And I stay with my late and beloved Aunt Tehlamo. And she milked the animals and made cheese and butter. And I took the animals up in the mountains for grazing. And Shea was my favorite place in the summer. It was so beautiful. And especially when you first get there, like their mountains are just covered with flowers and herbs. In fact, that's where I collected many of my father's herbs for his medicine. And in the summer, like late July, August, many tourists come here to circumambulate the Holy Mountain, which is called Crystal Mountain. And it is one of the holiest mountains in Dolgo, and many tourists and pilgrims come to walk around the mountain, which takes all day. And then we also have lots of festivals that happen around here. I'm so thankful that to this day that I had that as a child being out in the nature. There's something magical about just being completely surrounded by mountains, rivers, and that having that silence, the peace, complete peace and silence. No airplanes, no cars, nothing. Sometimes it's a little eerie because it's just you can hear your heartbeat, and you feel like the mountain is talking to you. In fact, we have spirit mountains and rivers, and we have lots of mountains that are holy. And I got into trouble one time when I went collecting sticks. So I had to take care of the animals. They also told me to have to go collect sticks for cooking our meals, which is really hard to do if you look at this. Do you see any sticks? I didn't see any bushes. Nope. So I have to literally look on the ground, and there's one, or dig a hole. So one time I spent all day and there was nothing. I came home with an empty basket. And just when I was about to be home, there's a river, and that river had all these sticks. I was like, oh my gosh, thank goodness. So I just put all the sticks in the basket and brought it home with this big pride, happy face, showed it to my grandmother. And my grandmother said, where did you get those sticks? I said, well, the river next to our house. She said, return them back to the river. Why? Because they belong to the rivers. I was like, oh, they're to the river, spirits in the river. So I was like, oh, are you sure? Yes, otherwise we'll get cursed. You need to return that back to the river. It belongs to the river. I was like, oh. So then I walked, all right, and give it to the river. I don't see why you don't want to share. I'm just really grateful that to have that experience as a young child, to have be surrounded by nature, and that's been helping as adults. And that, in fact, I can wait for a bus for 20 minutes. And nature taught me to have patience. Do you see any TV? No. Do you see any internet? No. So patience is very important. People in Dolgo don't want to leave because the landscape is beautiful, the air is crisp, clean, it's very peaceful, and it's a sacred place, it's a special sacred place. But it is really hard to survive because of lack of food, medical care, and also limited resource for education. So people have to make long journeys to cities, especially for medical help. And that's what my family and I did. One time, my parents discovered a lump on my back. At that time, we didn't know it was called scoliosis. And the minute that my parents saw the lump on my back, they knew it was bad because they've seen other children with similar condition as me die young. And by then, we have already lost 5 children, many relatives and village members from preventable deaths. So my parents said, we can't afford to lose another child. We need to do something. So we walked from Dobbo to the city of Kathmandu for a month. We didn't have, we had no money, no tents, just very little package. But we had to make some kind of sacrifice to see if we can find help. And we didn't also know if we will come back alive because people often, fall down and get sick. All kinds of things happen. But my parents took turn carrying my little brother on their back, and my sister and I walked along with them. One of the most scary things that happened during that journey was there was another family that was walking with us, and then we reached this mountain. I think it was at least 17 or 18,000 feet, and we were about to reach the top, and the little boy was starting to have breathing problem. And that was the most scary part, because we're out of nowhere. There's no hospital, there's nothing but the mountains. And we were just praying, and the wind was knocking us down. He was having problem breathing. But luckily we made it to the other side of the mountain. He was okay. But that's another reason these trips are very, very difficult. So we finally reached to the city, and life in the city wasn't easy either. We struggled. We got discriminated. We smelled like yak cheese. I like yak cheese. I don't see what your problem is. But whatever. But we had to beg in the city. My family and I had to take turn begging. And the doctors there said, we can't operate your daughter. So then now what? So we were thinking about going back to Dobbo, and that's another month of walking. But luckily, we saw an organization called Rokpa, and they had a soup kitchen in Kathmandu that was giving two free meals per day. And my family and I went there to eat. One day, my mother said, go to the stupa, pray, and come home. And this is the stupa. It's one of the holiest places in Kathmandu. And I stayed there a lot. It was I felt safe there, because once I reached the city, it was just so overwhelming. I mean, I'm just coming from this ancient world where I think that pictures fell from the sky. I think that buses are cows. I mean, I'm staring at the lights. So it's just, everything is just overwhelming. But the stupa was very calm. And so I was walking, and then as I was walking towards the stupa, I was thinking about my life. I don't want to go, what do I do? I don't want to, go back to Dobbo and die. And maybe I could run away, or maybe I can become a maid and stay longer, and hopefully somebody will find me, find help. And so as I was walking, I reached a fork path, and I stood in the middle. I looked, and at the Rokpa soup kitchen was Leah. She was the founder of Rokpa, and she had this bright green backpack. And I knew that Rokpa helped children with education and medical care. So I thought, maybe she can help me. And I was walking back and forth, stupa, soup kitchen, stupa, soup. And finally, I just walked straight to Leah. I kind of pulled her shirt and I said, Mami, I love to do in, and which means, Mama, I want to go to school. Because I knew everybody called her Mommy, and I also knew she spoke a little bit of Tibetan. So she was just sort of startled at first because she was surrounded by like children and people trying to get her attention. It was raining. It was just like all kinds of things were happening. But then she stopped and told the translator to get my family. And that's when my life changed. Going to the soup kitchen, I met my American family who was there volunteering, and they were listening to my story. As my family was telling my story to Ropa, they were there listening. And my, especially my mother, Jennifer, was right there. Mm-hmm. She was listening to my medical condition, and she took that story to America and asked doctors, here, please help this child, otherwise she will die. And I'm so grateful the doctors and my American family listened to my story, otherwise I wouldn't be here telling my story. Mm-hmm. And in this path, I also met my late German-American grandmother, who inspired me to write this book. First, she taught me English, and she said, you know, Dorje, there's editors who can edit your book. When I told her that I'm too terrified writing my own book because I can't spell, can't do grammar, still problem, nothing's, I'm still having problems spelling and grammar. I like to put S on everything. And so, yeah, I started writing, and there's other, so many people that encourage me to, you know, keep writing. And I'm so grateful I took that path. And this is the path where I met my other American grandmother, Margaret, who's here, very studious, exams tomorrow. And she has not missed a single Yak Girl talk. That's one that dedicated Fran. She's probably like, oh my God, listen to her again. But she's been an incredible person to inspire me to also write and continue this journey. I have a whole chapter just for grandparents, because I was raised by most of my grandparents, especially both grandparents and great-grandparents, so I have a great appreciation for grandparents. And this is path where my parents walked back to Dobo 4 more times, 1 month, carrying my other siblings on their back for medical help. And today, except for my one sister who lives in Dobo, all of my siblings are in school. They're in high school, they're in college, and getting master's degrees. In fact, my brother here that was in the box, and my brother that almost died from measles, he just got his master's degrees in Amsterdam. And I know it's been a while, but this is my cousin, the aunt that I went to in the summer, taking care of the animal with. She died when he was a baby. My mom had to breastfeed both him and my sister after his mom died. Unfortunately, my sister died. But we adopted him as another brother, and he's an amazing person. He calls me and tells me, you need to take a deep breath. tells me to be mindful. He's a monk. I'm working on that. It's like, I'm so stressed. Yeah. And he's like, peace. And in this path, I had two more brothers, American brothers, who wanted to listen to my stories from Nepal for bedtime, especially snow leopard stories or the wolves. So one time I was putting them to bed, and I had both one and both on each side. I was like 15 stories later, I was like about to head back to, you know, hoping they're sleeping, to a door, and one of them said, I saw a snow leopard. I was like, what? And then the other one said, could you tell me one more snow leopard story? I was like, all right. The last one that was on bed. And so lots of Nepal stories. And this is a path that I hope that, that my next dream is to help build a medical clinic in Dobro, because there's still people dying from basic colds. And in fact, recently one of my uncles passed away. He had a pneumonia, but he couldn't track down for 15 days. So right now I hope that I can help build a medical clinic up there. At the moment, I'm just learning from other people who have built clinics in remote areas. And I mean, how do you build a medical clinic in the most remote place at 13,000 feet with no electricity and no road? But that's how I felt when I started writing books, like, where do I begin? Have some more chips. Watch more movies. Day five, where do I begin? Watch one more movie. I believe that as long as you have basic shelter, food, and good health, you have the power to help others make a difference. And I hope that I can do the same with my book, with my writing and my art. I graduated from CU with an art degree. So this is one of my artwork that's in my book. And I'm donating part of my book proceeds to organizations that are helping Dobro in their way through education or medical needs. And this is the path that brought me to you all to share my story. And that's just my story. I just want you to let you all know that your story is very important. So I encourage you to write your own story, but listen to your friends and family's story. And I also wanted to thank my editor, Connie, right here. She made my book readable. Without her editing, it will say, "Yes, Girls" by Dorje Thomas. There's so many sheeps. And grammars are great. You know, it's like, she has spent hours, months, years, name it. She's probably getting so sick of me by now. But editing my book, so I'm so thankful to Connie and also my mom and grandma, who's been participating all of my Yak Girl talks. And this, I have one tomorrow, and then I go to East Coast on Saturday. So just, so if you want to follow my journey, you can sign up for my mailing list, follow me on my social media. I do a lot of my posting on my Facebook page. And I also have a GoFundMe that's helping me pay for my tour. So just so you don't think I'm making up this place, I'm going to show a little video clip of a documentary film about my family. It's called The Only Son. It was shown in 2014 during Boulder International Film Festival. And the story is that it's the struggle between ancient culture and tradition versus modern world. And the story centers around my brother Pema.
Karan, village high in the Himalayas in Nepal. This is where I was born. But me and five of my sisters couldn't survive there. My parents brought us to a children's home in Kathmandu. Recently, I got a chance to study in the Netherlands and live with my sister Sujo and her Dutch mom. I feel further away from my parents than ever.
Yeah,
Just like the match, stubborn Zoe. My mom is very stubborn too. But I have to give her credit for being such a strong person after losing so many children and having to sacrifice, giving all us up for a better future.
Why did you want to go down in the hole after the snow leopard when you knew it was like enclosed?
I like to think later, at first, think later. I think it's just like, I take my job very seriously. I'm risking my life for this already. But I think I want that to go back even if it's one horn. But that night, I was like, what were you thinking? Like, even my grandfather was like, what were you thinking? I kind of trust it wouldn't eat me. Yeah.
Where can we buy your book?
You can buy it on Amazon, at the Boulder Bookstore, or through me. But the Boulder Bookstore has plenty of Decker books. I just had it recently. My book launched there, and 130 people came. It was a pretty wild night. Any other questions?
You said that visitors and pilgrims, tourists and pilgrims came. You said men. It was men. Three or?
Well, yeah. Yeah, I think at the time when I was there, I wrote this book, my life was like 23 years ago, and but back then there were some Western tourists came, and sometimes two or three, but also pilgrims from different villages, some from Tibet, some from, so in Dover there are a lot of little villages, if there's a great festival happening, everybody comes. So it's mostly Taiwans and the other times Western truckers. But yeah, at first I was so confused. I'm like, so they just want to walk up a really tall mountain? I was trying to figure out the purpose. Is there a goat stuck up there? I mean, what? They were just doing trekking.
Yeah, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about recent infrastructural, particularly road developments in Dolpo. So Mustang is getting a lot of roads, Humla is getting a lot of roads. So what's happening in Dolpo?
There are some roads. They're working towards building road. It's just taking a really long time. It's really the lower part of Dolpo is like the whole region, and there's upper and lower. Upper is where I'm from because I like to be in the most difficult area at all times. And that's really hard to build road because the mountains are really steep. They are currently working on building a road.
Is there a road from the border down? Like, is China building,
that, I don't know. That might happen. Like, where my village, it's really close to Tibet. We do, that's like an ancient tradition, we go to Tibet to get salt, trade salt, and so we are very familiar going back and forth. But, I don't know about that part of it, but in the lower area they are building roads, and the airport part is a little closer, but you still have to track like 10, 15 days.
All right, well, please join me once more in thanking Dorothy.